Hello and welcome to the new series of Drishti IAS. I am Pooja Dwivedi, and in this segment today we are going to discuss about the rise of Chinese naval power. This topic is important from the perspective of prelims and also from the perspective of GS mains papers. So let's begin with the first topic. Why is it in the news? China has become a maritime power. It's time India caught up. Now this article has been taken from Indian Express, and this is basically an opinion article, but we will analyze every facet of it. So as we can see, this data which has been provided by the Congressional Research Service. Yeah, this is actually from source from China itself. So you can trust this. And there has been an increment since the year 2006, and there has been a steady rise somewhere. You can see there has been a rise, there has been a dip, and it has remained stable. But since 2018 and 19 and 20, it has been increasing. You can see the color-wise segregation of the number of aircraft carriers, destroyers, and corvettes. They have been introduced since 2014, and these have been seeing a steady rise. You can see that. And this article which says Chinese Navy ships lurk near Taiwan's waters. Why South China Sea is important for the Chinese and every other country that has the littoral boundary with it, the other littoral states. We will discuss that. And moving on, you can see the building or amalgamation of the sea power of China from Spratly Islands to Hambantota Port, Maldives, Mauritius, Tanzania, Djibouti, Gwadar Port. So much has been done by the Chinese naval force in order to surround India, because India is one of the countries in Asia that is rising enough to become a superpower in the next, not very soon, but going to be in the next 50 to 70 years. So that is the reason. And as you can see, Chinese fleet headquarters going from, you can see the blue lines. This is the Chinese fleet headquarters. It is proving a challenge to be American Navy bases as well. Why is South China Sea so important for China? South China Sea is basically an arm of the Western Pacific Ocean in Southeast Asia. And it is south of China, east and south of Vietnam, west of the Philippines, and also north of the island of Borneo. And if we talk about it, the bordering states and territories, you can see the People's Republic of China is there, Taiwan is there, Philippines, Malaysia, Brunei, Indonesia, Singapore, and Vietnam. And it is connected by the Taiwan Strait with the East China Sea and Luzon Strait with the Philippines. And here, my actual intent here is to show you the 9 dash line, right? This 9 dash line. So 9 dash line stretches hundreds of kilometers south and east of China's southerly Henan Island. Okay, from Henan Island, here we have the Henan Island. From Henan, covering the strategic Paracel, as you can see, Paracel, Spratly, and also Scarborough Shoal, James Shoal, China claims it by citing 2000 years of history when the two island chains were regarded as an integral part of China. That is why, on the basis of the 9 dash line, China has said that we have control over this part. Moving on, if we talk about China's naval power, right? At the 18th Party Congress in 2012, the then president Hu Jintao called for China to become a maritime power capable of safeguarding its maritime rights and interests. President Xi Jinping reiterated this position in April 2018 when he stated that the task of building a powerful navy has never been as urgent as it is today. China's 2019 Defense White Paper further outline the need to build a strong and modernized naval force that is capable of carrying out missions on the far seas. Between 2014 to 18, China launched more submarines, warships, amphibious vessels, and auxiliaries than the number of ships currently serving in the individual navies of Germany, India, Spain, and the UK. 18 ships were commissioned by China in 2016 alone, and at least another 14 were added in 2017. By comparison, the US Navy commissioned 5 ships in 2016 and 8 ships in 2017. Should China continue to commission ships at the similar rate, it could have 425 Battle 4 ships by 2030. Now let's talk a bit about the very important region, which is the Indo-Pacific. Now, Indo-Pacific is this entire darker region as compared to its surroundings. And Indo-Pacific, but it's right, has been quite significant in the recent years. One of the reasons behind the popularity of this term is understanding that Indian Ocean and Pacific Ocean, these are linked as a strategic theater. It is important for the strategy of different countries. Also, the center of gravity has shifted to Asia right now. Now, the reason being maritime routes, the sole reason. The Indian Ocean and Pacific, it provides sea lanes, and majority of the world trade, it passes through this region and this ocean. There was a time before the Cold War when the center of gravity of the universe was across the Atlantic. That is, trade was actually transiting from the Atlantic, but now it has shifted. Now, the earlier term used to be Asia-Pacific, from which India was excluded. This term was prevalent during the Cold War times, and the shift to the term from Asia-Pacific to Indo-Pacific is because of the growing heft of India. And the term Indo-Pacific, although has been accepted universally, but it has different interpretation. For example, for India, India considers the region as an inclusive, open, integrated and balanced space. And the US considers it to be free and open Indo-Pacific, highlighting the importance of rules of norms of conduct in the region, and thus trying to contain the role of China in this particular region. Also, the ASEAN countries, they look at Indo-Pacific as a consociational model, thus bringing in China, not only for the sake of giving it some stakeholdership, but looking it for the ways to cooperate with China. So you can see the growing heft and different interpretation. Now, as you can see, according to this article, India's delayed aircraft carrier plans raises concerns as China readies its third one. And China's Type 003 makes substantial progress while Indian Navy operates with one. This is one of the challenges that we need to upgrade with our Navy in a proper time-bound manner. Now, some things have been done by India to counterbalance it. For example, the Maritime Indian Vision of 2030. Policy initiatives and development projects under it are a fund of ₹25,000 crore, which will provide low-cost, long-tenure financing to the sector, with the center contributing 2,500 crore over 7 years. Port regulatory authority is also there. A Pan-India Port Authority will be set up under the new Indian Ports Act to replace the old Indian Ports Act of 1908 for enabling oversight across major and non-major ports, enhance institutional coverage for ports, and provide for structured growth and the port sector to boost investor confidence. Eastern Waterways Connectivity Transport Grid Project, it will aim to provide regional connectivity with Bangladesh, Nepal, Bhutan and Myanmar. Riverine Development Fund, which calls for extending low-cost, long-term financing for island vessels with the support of Riverine Development Fund and for extending the coverage of the tonnage tax scheme that is applicable to ocean-going ships and dredgers to Indian vessels, and also to enhance the availability of such vessels. Rationalization of port charges will make them more competitive, besides doing away with all hidden charges levied by shipliners to bring in more transparency, and promotion of water transport for decongestion of urban areas and developing waterways as an alternative means of urban transport. Moving on, there is also another very important international informal organization. It's not an organization, it can be called an association, a grouping, the Quad. Now, Quad is a grouping of India, USA, Australia and Japan. It aims to safeguard the interest of democratic nations in the Indo-Pacific region and address global challenges, and it can be seen, and it has already been seen by China as a threat. So, this particular association has also a very important segment by the name of Malabar Exercise. Can you please tell me in the comment segment, when was the Malabar Exercise started, among which countries, and now how many countries are there, and the latest one to join the Malabar Exercise? Moving on, let's talk about certain challenges. Now, Sagarmala is a program which held out greater hopes because it was structured before Progress Monitoring Framework. Sagarmala program was approved by the Union Cabinet in the year 2015. It aimed at holistic port infrastructure development along the coastline through modernization, mechanization and computerization. However, data from Ministry of Shipping Sagarmala project tracker, updated until September 2019, shows a project completion rate no better than the past trends. This is a challenge for us. Tellingly, while the plan aimed to create 40 lakh direct jobs and 60 lakh indirect jobs in 2019, the government admitted that only 10,000 jobs had been created. Then another thing, which is the Maritime Agenda 2010 to 2020. So this particular agenda had the agenda for creating ports capacity of 32 megaton for handling about 2500 megaton of cargo, increasing India's share in global shipbuilding to approximately 5%. Also increase India's share of seafarer to 9% of the global strength by the year 2015. And also develop two new major ports, one each on east and west coast. Also establishing Indian ports global for overseas investment by Indian ports. But a reading of the MA 2020 document served to seriously undermine its credibility on two things. First, it had set extremely unrealistic targets. When you set unrealistic targets, it's next to impossible to achieve it. And then comes the underachievement. Aiming to increase in just 7 to 8 years shipbuilding capacity by 5 times and enhancing cargo throughout in the Indian ports by 4 times. And secondly, it showed clear signs of confusion in the ministry, citing itself a roadmap to guide the ministry in one place. And while stating elsewhere that it was more an agenda for consideration rather than agenda for action, that means it was said that we set it for consideration but not to toe the line according to it. So there is a confusion. Predictably, this failed to achieve anything of substance before it was overtaken by the next plan. So what is the way forward? We need to first keep an eye on initiating programs with any sort of inappropriate aims that can't be achieved, or choosing very high, over-ambitious targets, abandoning remaining projects and looking to the next project, not completing the previous project and moving on to the next important project, and not ensuring any faithful implementation. These are the reasons which need to be addressed so that we can move way forward. Now it is time India evolved a national strategy for the maritime sector that charts a 50-year path and receives Parliament's approval to ensure survival throughout the changes of government so that it can remain stagnant yet a little flexible. So let's move on to our question. Analyze the criticality of building a strong naval power for India in contemporary times. You have to write it in 250 words. So that's it for today. Tomorrow we shall meet again with another segment. Until then, stay updated and thank you so much for watching.